My guest today is Karen Kamensek, who is the conductor for The Elixir of Love by Donizetti. Karen, welcome.
Thank you.
Good to have you back in the United States. I know you're originally from here, Chicago, but now you are the music director and chief conductor at the opera house in Hannover in Germany. My first question, right out of the gate, how did you get there? How did that happen?
A long and windy road. A series of serendipitous events led me to Germany after a long time of the typical artistic struggle in New York City and trying to get a break in the States, and that didn't happen at the time. Mm-hmm. Simone Young, who was conducting at the Met at the time, I approached her and basically told her I was going to be her assistant. Yeah. I didn't leave her much of a choice. But,
and where was she conducting at the time?
She was at the Met, but she was the chief conductor of the Symphony Orchestra in Bergen in Norway.
Okay.
And I knew she was freelancing as an opera conductor as well. So I just approached her and just said, you need an assistant, and that's me. And it took her another 3 years to answer me, but she did eventually after I'd given up all hope. And she brought me to Europe, and her manager saw me conduct a portion of a rehearsal, which she gifted me.
Nice.
And then he signed me. He took me on as a client and basically created many opportunities at a very big risk. But I think he's gotten payback since then.
So you've been there ever since?
Yeah, I started in Vienna at the Volksoper, which was, you know, into the frying pan, basically.
Right.
And he said, his line was, you know, you've got enough technique. I've seen you conduct enough that you're going to survive the evening. And if you're really terrible, everybody will just forget that you were ever here. It won't make that much of a difference. But if you survive, then you have a chance to swim further. So I swam and swam.
And you were attached to that theater for a while, were you not?
For two seasons.
For two seasons.
Yeah.
And now in Hannover, you've been there how long?
This is my third.
Now, what are your responsibilities there?
Music is a small portion, actually, of my responsibility. Actual conducting is about, I'd say, 20% of the job.
Yeah.
There's an enormous amount of administration, auditions for singers, for orchestra members. The chorus auditions are separate. I don't have to do that. Programming, a certain amount of publicity, different than it is here because we're, of course, subsidized mostly by the government.
Right.
We have very few sponsors, so that financial burden is not on my shoulders.
Thank goodness.
The intendant or the general director, he has to fight with the city and the state to get the funding, but
right.
I'm pretty much held out of that.
And how is the funding going there? I mean, I know all over Europe funding is beginning to be whittled
fighting,
away.
We're fighting. We have a cultural minister who's a little bit working against us at the moment. She thinks she's doing good things, but it's kind of counterproductive. And her statements about us are completely false. She wishes for us to have more integration of different cultures. And I think we have like 60 nations represented in our institution at all. And we cater to all age groups, as you must, if you want to survive.
Any opera company does that. That's rather short.
So we're not cutting musical positions yet. And that would be a breach of my contract anyway. So that's my trump card,
right.
And also the trump card of the intendant. But we've cut back in administration and some in the technical department, which is a catastrophe because the less technicians you have, the fewer technicians you have, the less the. I can't speak English anymore. I'm speaking English like a German. You can't play as many productions because you don't have the turnover. So it's sort of a Teufelskreis. What's that called?
Catch-22. Oh, a catch-22. There you go. How is the audience in Hannover? Is it, can you identify it as being conservative or progressive or somewhere in the middle?
I think they're pretty much in the middle.
Yeah.
And we have a good cross-section through all the demographics, and we try to cover all of our bases. We have a very growing and highly praised youth opera program.
Wonderful.
We cater to kids. We have operas that are suitable for the 6-year-old group, the 10-year-old group, the 16-year-old group, and even the 18-year-old groups.
Different repertoire for each? Wow.
And we have a studio program, so young singers that are presenting these groups, and sometimes some of the singers from the main ensemble sing also. Usually those are all commissioned pieces by young composers, mostly German composers.
Mm-hmm.
And so that covers a whole age bracket that is crucially important to us. We have a ballet also, so a lot of young people come to the ballet. It's a very popular venue for them, and they'll come to the, you know, the bohems, the Hänsel and Gretel, the popular things. And then we have the people who are hardcore avant-gardists. When we do a modern piece, you know, they fill those 300 seats every night. You know, but
300 seats, excuse me.
On those nights.
Oh, okay.
The modern opera nights. And and I mean, we have the general elderly population also, but I wouldn't, you know, I couldn't give you a percentage, but it looks very, when I'm standing on stage, it looks very balanced.
How many seats are in the houses?
1,200.
1,200.
Yeah.
So that's pretty intimate.
Yeah.
As far as United States standards go, because now you're conducting in a 3,200 seat house.
Right.
We're big.
Yeah.
And sometimes a lot of times, I miss that intimacy that you find in a lot
European
of the European
houses.
Theaters. It makes a huge
difference.
Well,
you're going to be hard-pressed to find something over 2,500 seats in Europe
And you also have a very broad repertoire. I looked at the list of things that you've done up to this point and what you're projecting on Opera Base on our database. And
it's a long list, isn't it?
Oh, my gosh. Well, that's
funny
that's
how
the,
that happens.
That's the neat thing, I guess, about being a resident music director in a house like that, that you guys do so much. You do it from Puccini and Wagner and
Janáček. Well, you're just seeing what I've done in the last 3 years.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, and I mean, I was fest in, or a resident conductor in Vienna for those 2 years, and they hired me to do basically 5 pieces, and I wound up doing about 8 the first season because they figured out that I could actually conduct, and they said, well, let's let her do a little more. And over the course of 2 seasons, sorry, I have something in my eye. Over the course of 2 seasons, I had 15 new operas.
Wow.
And then I was freelance for a bit, and then I went to Freiburg for 3 years and did 3 premieres a season there. Everything pretty much new. Now I'm starting to repeat things, which is a great pleasure. Like, this is a repeat for me, which is... But it's my first... it's called an Einstudium, where I prepare the orchestra as well. Usually I'm jumping into things or just doing it with one rehearsal.
I see.
But this is a real premiere for me where I get the orchestra time as well.
So, bringing it to the present, how are things going in rehearsal? Are you having a good time with this particular cast?
We laugh a lot. We laugh at each other a lot. Uh-huh. We make a lot of jokes. I mean, it's a comedy of sorts. It's a melodrama, but it's a melodrama opera buffa. So, it's a great atmosphere, very talented people. We're all well prepared and work intensively and have fun.
That's so great.
Yeah, I mean, the subject matter, you know, no one dies.
Yeah.
So it's like nobody's digging into their soul for some kind of darkness.
Yeah.
I mean, everything, it's a lot of tongue-in-cheek. Of course, there are darknesses in each of these characters, but it has a happy ending.
That's the interesting part about it. I mean, we're so used to calling Elixir a comedy, and you're right, it really isn't. There are moments of... sentiment and melancholy in the piece.
Absolutely.
That give it just a little bit of a different color than
you would
get from...
Well, he also calls it a melodrama himself. Now, that has to do with the fact that there are a lot of recitatives in there, and they are accompanied by a keyboard instrument.
Uh-huh.
And that would qualify it, because it's one of the, I think, the only opera where he did that.
Right. But it's such a gorgeous piece. What do you think is the essence of bel canto? Kind of touched on this with
bel canto.
But I've kind of touched on this with the two singers that I've interviewed so far, Giuseppe and Tatiana, who are singing the roles of Nemorino and Adina. But how do you see it from the musical standpoint, from the conductor's standpoint? What is bel canto?
A lot of it has to do with compositional style, of course, and the structure of the piece also. You have the aria, the duet, the trio, the quartet, the big ensemble, the chorus. That is something that goes away once Wagner and Strauss come into the picture, and also later Verdi. Bel canto has definitely to do with the vocal style, a lot of repetition of text. It's not one through story, it's very mannered. They repeat words, on long passage work. Coloratura is important, sfioratura is important, all these ornaments. Long legato lines, cadenzas, you know, trills, the handling of the text, in the duets, the harmonization, completely different from Mozart. I mean, Mozart was just before it. but yeah. not quite there yet. It's completely different.
In the handling of the text, is that something that you work with the singers in rehearsal to, let's say, stress or color certain sure. words or certain phrases?
Sure. Now, these singers have all sung these parts before, so they come offering something to me. It's not like working with someone who's doing it for the first time. Right. You know, there's an unspoken tradition to these pieces that gets carried on through the generations that we learn from either conductors or opera coaches or singers. Or, you know, this immense library of recordings that we gratefully have because, yeah. you know, we can't travel around to everywhere and hear people. But we listen, we hear the traditions, and then you have to pick and choose what you like and what you're seeking as a team, basically.
Mm-hmm. What works, too.
What works.
In a particular space. It might be different here than it is in Hanover.
And, you know, we're all relatively young. We're all relatively the same age. But generally, I would say, you know, you don't work with a 20-year-old singing one role the way you work with a 50-year-old singing the same role. You have to take certain right. things into account.
Right, right.
So,
what are you looking forward to conducting next? What's coming up?
Just after this, I'm doing Britten's Midsummer Night's Dream in Hanover, so I'm looking forward to that. And just after that, I do Das Lied von der Erde, Mahler, several concerts. And then I'm back. I'm actually in San Jose doing a huge concert with the Silicon Valley Symphony in May.
Oh, wonderful.
So I'll be there just along to get over my jet lag and go back. And then I'm at the San Francisco Opera in September.
Oh, terrific. Yeah. And what are you doing for San Francisco?
Carlo Floyd's Susanna.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah. Great piece. Mm-hmm. That brought up one last question. Then I take it then that with the orchestra in Hanover, you don't just do opera, you also do the occasional
full symphonic series.
A complete series.
Yeah, we do.
Wow, that's
eight concerts plus a New Year's concert plus a whole series of youth concerts and children's concerts. I don't do all of them. I have five conductors in-house, including myself. So.
Still, you're busy.
I'm busy, yeah, yeah. The days of unemployment, musical unemployment, I hope, are behind me forever. I know, something can always change.
Well, thank you so much for being with us. I'm looking forward, as I'm sure our audience is looking forward to your conducting, Elixir, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you. Thanks. Bye.